I will try to stay on time. I know it's been a long day for everyone, and looking over the chat, it's a bit of a tough crowd, and I will do my best to, you know, present some new results. This is actually the first time I will be presenting this particular talk, and I hope it will be of practical benefit to you while being not just one guy's opinion, but based in academic research. As Rafael mentioned, I'm the founder and CEO of Sweetwater Digital Asset Consulting. I see myself as bridging two very separate worlds, which know very little about each other, and in fact, oftentimes have little but stereotype and prejudice to cast the other in. Those two worlds are that of cypherpunk cryptocurrency open source projects, such as Monero or Bitcoin. And then on the other side of this bridge is the traditional finance world. So as Rafael mentioned, I was head of research at a hedge fund, and so that is what I prepared my remarks to cover today. Here's a taxonomy of assets. These are all the things that are out there that are possible to invest in for those who have wealth to invest. And I'm dividing this into two rows. There's fungible and non-fungible. So roughly, fungible means that you don't care which thing you get, because from your point of view, all the things that you could get are all the same. So if you look at the fungible bottom row here, we're looking at cash and precious metals. So if you have gold, you can always melt it down. There's no history associated with any piece of gold. And so from your point of view, as long as you know that something is gold, you don't care where it came from. Gold is gold. It's fungible. In the decentralized world, the leader in that market segment is currently Monero. There's also non-fungible, which is on the top. And that is, you do care which particular unit of value that you're getting, because they're not the same. So let's think about real estate or artworks. If you have a plot of land, there's presumably reasons that you chose that plot of land. And it's not really cool for you to just get whatever plot of land that comes out of some grab bag or something. Land is not fungible. And it's the same with works of art. So Bitcoin falls in that category, in that there's a record, a digital record that is really etched in stone of everybody who had a piece of that value in the Bitcoin blockchain before you did. And so for people who have a squeaky clean reputation, who have worked hard, played by the rules their whole life, they want to be insulated from the potential misdeeds of other people who are on that same network, which means that Bitcoin is going to fail these people. Bitcoin is going to fail these people because sometimes these squeaky clean people are going to deal with other people on the Bitcoin blockchain who are not as squeaky clean as they are. And because in a surveillance coin, a transparent coin like Bitcoin, reputation transfers as well as value, that means that the squeaky clean person's reputation is going to be besmirched by chance, by having done some sort of random financial transaction with someone on the Bitcoin blockchain who's not as squeaky clean as they are. So a classic example would be a squeaky clean person has a car and they sell it to somebody for Bitcoin, and unbeknownst to them, the person who they sold their car to got their Bitcoin by dealing on the dark web or some nefarious activity. So it's a bit counterintuitive, but the conclusion of this, and this is also supported by some Nobel Prize-winning research in economics, for example, the Akerlof paper, which studies behavior of participants in a market when buyers and sellers have different levels of information on what's being traded. The conclusion of that is that the squeaky clean people are going to leave that market in which their goodness basically is not compensated for, and they are going to go to a coin that will protect them, like Monero. But let's step back for a minute. Let's talk about fiat currency and scarcity in general, and why is it that we even care about cryptocurrency to start with? The G20 is the collection of 20 of the largest world economies. What I'm showing here is the amount of money supply that each of these countries has out in circulation. The left-hand side of this plot is 2009, which is the year that Bitcoin became a thing. And this goes all the way to data that I collected just a couple of days ago from the Federal Reserve website. And what I've done is that no matter how big or how small any country's currency is, they labeled as having a value of 1 at the beginning of 2020. And so what you can see is that every fiat currency in the world turned on the printing presses at an accelerating rate after the pandemic hit. Before the pandemic, there was even still reason for quite a bit of concern, because if you look, this is 0.5 here, which means that in the time period between 2012 and 2020, that's 8-year period, that's a doubling of most countries' fiat supplies. If something doubles every 8 years, then think about what the impact of that is over your lifetime. So let's say the average person lives 80 years, then this doubling is going to happen 10 times. And when something doubles a bunch of times, it gets big fast. That's exponential growth. In this case, it would be 2 to the 10th power, which is about 1,000. So that's a 1,000 times inflation in the money supply over one's lifetime. And that is using the rate of growth before the pandemic. After the pandemic, we're looking at a doubling time that's closer to maybe 2 years. The reason that it's disguised a bit is that everybody else is doing it too. So if everyone else is doing it, then we don't look quite as bad on a relative basis with other countries. However, since 2009, there has been such a thing as decentralized scarcity. There has been a thing called Bitcoin, which manufactured a way to synthesize digital scarcity without needing a central authority to maintain that scarcity. What I'm showing here is year-over-year supply inflation. In green, you're looking at how much USD was there in 1 year versus the year previous. And I'm looking at MZM, which is a broad measure of money supply, which includes checking, savings accounts, and money market accounts. There is a multiplier effect here if you want to get technical, but you know, at the end of the day, all of these measures of money supply show the same thing. There's a giant spike at the pandemic, and the giant spike has not gone away. In contrast to that, let's look at these alternate forms of scarcity that are not controlled by a central government, the classic one being gold. Now, the World Gold Council does an estimate of how much gold is being dug out of the ground every year. It's been inflating at about 1.8% per year, and that's been pretty consistent over the last 10 years at least. So now let's plot against that the corresponding inflation figures for Bitcoin and Monero. The thing with cryptocurrencies is, unlike even gold, it can be predicted in advance what the inflation rate is going to be in the supply of that currency. So this is one of the big features of cryptocurrency, is that the of future coin emissions has been programmed in advance, and it's enforced by the entire network of computers that is helping to do the bookkeeping for each respective network. So Bitcoin computers have programmed them this future inflation curve, and the same with Monero. And you can see that we're coming in on this inflection point here. In mid-2021, the rate of year-over-year supply inflation is going to cross that of gold and go than that of gold, and it will remain lower than that of gold forever. Now, in the Monero project, of course, as you've heard all day, the big kind of uniting ethos of the Monero community is we want this form of scarce value to be fungible. In other words, it introduces all sorts of meat space level problems. This is social level problems when a source of value is completely traceable. First of all, it invites the participation of these so-called chain analysis companies, whose job it is to try to analyze the flow of funds in a transparent chain and basically dox people. But the thing is, they have incomplete information of the economic activity on the chain. All they can see is that money changed hands from person A to person B. They have no knowledge of the context, which means it's easy for them to come to false conclusions. So let's go back to that example of the car seller. Somebody sells their car for Bitcoin. They receive Bitcoin that came from a drug dealer or some bad person. Now the innocent person who sold their car has a problem, because these chain analysis people know that a quote-unquote bad person supplied the Bitcoin that this innocent car seller now has. So now when this innocent car seller goes to put their Bitcoin on an exchange to sell it back for USD, they're going to get flagged and be forced to defend themselves against these accusations that were made on incomplete, partial information by a third party who is looking at this blockchain data from afar and applying basically a social credit score to every participant on that network, providing that social credit score to its customers, which are going to be things like exchanges and so on. And they're going to wash their hands of any inaccuracies. They'll say, well, we did our best. We came up with a 72.3% chance that this person was actually bad. And so, you know, if that turns out to be wrong, well, I'm sorry. But really, they're not really that sorry. And the people who they are surveilling and making these social credit scores for have no recourse to clear up their name in case they're falsely accused. So again, in Monero, the ethos is that the best solution for humanity's needs is going to be a fungible coin. And it turns out that this is easier said than done, because digital assets have at their heart strings of ones and zeros, which are obviously unique. You can tell one string of ones and zeros from another string of ones and zeros. And so to effectively manufacture fungibility out of something that is inherently extremely easy to tell apart from one another, that is numbers, it takes considerable ingenuity. And it is not something that can just be slapped on. And so what I'm showing in this chart here in the top is the daily average bytes per transaction that is taken up on the Monero blockchain. So this is how much disk space is taken up when one person in Monero decides to send Monero to somebody else. And you can see that it's gone through some history here. There was a innovation in Monero called RingCT, which sought to keep confidential the amounts that are sent between the sender and receiver. And even though this innovation caused the size of transactions to go up over an order of magnitude, the community decided it was worth it to do it. Then later on, there was bulletproofs, which is basically clever mathematics, which found that, oh, these cryptographic proofs that we're using to guarantee integrity of the Monero system while preserving the privacy of the amounts transacted, gee, there's a new way we can do that that takes up a lot less byte space than it used to. That went through an audit process, and after that came back, it was implemented. And then you can see that the transaction size went back down. Now, last Halloween, there was a new innovation called CLSAGs that also went in, and that chipped away at the transaction side a bit more. The point being that this community has done what it takes to make sure that fungibility is in the blockchain and improved in the blockchain. And there's continual research happening on this front. On the bottom, we're looking at the daily average transaction fee in US dollars for both Bitcoin and Monero. And you can see that when bulletproofs went in at the end of 2018, not only did the transaction size drop by order of magnitude, the transaction fee also dropped by basically the same amount. And so today, to make a transaction in Monero, the average transaction is on the order of pennies, US pennies. And the median is actually below one penny. This is a chain that puts a high priority on the needs of its users. It's a customer-first sort of mentality. So the thinking is that the users of Monero might be people in oppressive regimes who are trying to escape a draconian, cruel government with their lives and their life savings, and they might need something to escape that is truly fungible and not traceable. It's people like that who the developers are developing Monero for. All right, so that was a very quick summary of some of my previous videos. Anyone who starts from zero and watches these videos will be more informed than, I would say, 80% of the other people who are dabbling in cryptocurrency. The names of these videos are Monero Sound Money Safe Mode, and the one preceding that was called Monero Means Money. I think it's quite rare for videos like this to get good reception, both from developer types for technical accuracy, as well as non-technical types who appreciate the clarity of the explanations. These are something that I've worked quite hard on, and I don't mean to, you know, really self-promote, but this is a recommendation because in the chat, I saw that there were quite a few new people who could use a kind of a solid background level introduction to this stuff. Volunteers in the Monero community have graciously taken time to translate the subtitles in this These videos have been or are in the process of being translated into several European languages. Basically, we want this narrative that fungibility and privacy in Monero is for squeaky clean people too. They are the ones who need it most. And so if that message is absent in any given society, you might have a tendency for regulators to assume that there are no squeaky clean people using Monero. And we want to avoid that misperception because it is a misperception. All right, so now on to the new content of this talk. So one thing you will hear, especially from proponents of the number one market cap crypto currently, that is Bitcoin, one thing you will hear a lot is this phrase, the markets have spoken. What we're looking at here is CoinGecko.com. What they do is they get a list of all the cryptocurrency projects out there. They ask the question, how many units of value are out there for each of these cryptocurrencies? And what was the most recent trading price for each of these units of scarcity? And they multiply the two. When you multiply those two, you get a measure called market cap. And what that means is roughly, what is the value of all of the Bitcoin in the world? So if you were to take everyone's Bitcoin and put it in a giant pot, what would it be worth? Now, of course, that's a difficult question because if one person had it, then its value would automatically go down because there's a network effect. But the approximation of using the number of units times the latest market price, that's kind of one of the better forms of estimate that we have for the value of a project. And so this website takes all of the projects and ranks them. So which cryptocurrency has the largest market cap? It's Bitcoin. Number two is Ethereum. Number three is Tether. I would imagine even if you're new to cryptocurrency, you're familiar with a list of this kind. And this is a screenshot from earlier today. And so now you see down here at number 20 is Monero. So, you know, if Monero has all these great characteristics, well, why is it down at number 20 then? And so this is a question that comes up. And as it happens, my previous background in finance includes questions of this nature. And so that's what I'd like to talk about. So the markets have spoken, or have they? I know that this group is quite familiar with the debate in macroeconomics, that is political economics, of Keynes versus Hayek. So I won't go into that at all. I'll assume that you all are versed in at least the basics of that debate, which happens at a national kind of political level, at the macroeconomic level. But I don't know if many are aware of this because I actually never hear crypto people talk about this. And so I hope that this is actually something new and interesting in the crypto space today. And that is, in microeconomics, there is a similar debate that's going on, and it has been going on for decades. And this is neoclassical economics versus behavioral economics. So first, I'll define what I'm talking about, and I'll give a few examples from the traditional capital markets, and then I'll move to the crypto markets. So neoclassical economics came first, so I'll talk about that first. It's the more old school version of the worldview. And there are two assumptions, basically, in neoclassical economics, and they are the following. People are rational. That means every person will maximize their own utility. And utility is just an economics word that you could replace that with happiness. People do what they can to maximize their own happiness, given the constraints that they face due to having, you know, a certain budget that they have to deal with. Second is that markets are efficient. And what that means is that all of the information about any given asset is encoded into the price. And so there's no way to game the system at all. The market price of every asset is always the correct price that incorporates all known information about that asset. Another way to say this, in the words of Dr. Eugene Fama, who's a professor of University of Chicago, and also was one of the recipients of the Nobel in Economics for furthering theories along this point of view, is to say that there are no bubbles. There's no such thing as a bubble. All right, the challenging view is behavioral economics. So that is the following. Let's take that as a given. Okay, people are rational. Okay, let's take it as a given. Markets are efficient. Now let's also observe that Wall Street makes up 21% of US GDP. So now something is a little fishy here. So if people are so smart and rational, why do they need this gigantic financial sector to help them do anything? If markets are so efficient, why is there so much sales, so much profit to be made in the financial sector? Anyone kind of sympathetic to the ethos of cryptocurrency is going to, I think, agree quite wholeheartedly with this. One thing that crypto has the potential to disintermediate is this 21% of the US economy. So in the words of Dr. Richard Thaler, and also a University of Chicago professor who is one of the founders of behavioral economics and also a Nobel Prize winner, he says pick two. So one of these assumptions has to be false, that people are rational or markets are efficient, or maybe both. Now, I should add, just speaking as a physicist, that when economists modeled people to be these rational, efficient happiness maximizers, why did they do that? That enabled them to use the language of mathematics, because if you think about maximization problems, there's a branch of calculus, like, for example, variational calculus, basically tools in mathematics that can be used to apply to the problem once you have this quantitative definition of people's behavior as being maximization of some function. So that enabled economists to kind of become a science, so to speak, and imitate the success of harder sciences like physics in their quantitative exploration of the way the world works. The drawback of this is, that is it true? Is it really true to make these assumptions? So the behavioral economics worldview breaks down like this. Econs are rational, and econs are the word for the fictitious human-like forms that are hypothesized in the old school neoclassical economics. So econs, you could think of like Dr. Spock, right? They're kind of robot people. They make perfect decisions under data, and they would never do anything to sabotage their own self. So econs are rational. Markets that are made of econs are efficient. What behavioral economics does is to add the following caveat. Actual people are dumber, both dumber in terms of intelligence and nicer in terms of altruism. Because one feature, I think, that's evolved in humanity is that there's a sort of an innate desire in many people to kind of get along. You don't want to perpetually be at war with your neighbors. You might do a nice thing for somebody from time to time, even though that might not be strictly in your economic best interest, like making a donation or something like that. These are aspects of human behavior that don't really fit well with the view of people being econs. All right, so in behavioral economics, the observation is that actual people are both dumber and nicer than econs, and in predictable ways. And so that is the interesting part of this. All right, so I'm going to give a couple examples of how this shows up in capital markets, but first I have to give a 101 of accounting. So the fundamental identity of accounting is A equals L plus E. You can think of that as ale, like the drink. So that is sort of a mnemonic to remember this. What this is saying is that every company, or it could be a person, or it could be a country, it works at any sort of level. But let's just stick with the example of a company. A company is a thing that has a bunch of assets. It might have factories and so on. These assets get divided into two parts. There are people who that the company owes money to. It basically had to get a loan from the bank, or if it's big enough, maybe it would have issued its own corporate bonds. Those are basically IOUs. Those are liabilities. And under corporate legal structure, if a company goes bankrupt and these assets get sold, then the liabilities must get paid first. The people who made loans of cold hard cash, they must be first in line to get the pickings of the dead company's sold assets. So whatever is not owed to outside lenders is the property of the owners, and that is equity. And this is the stock market. So this is the bond market on top. This is the stock market on bottom. So they add up. So you have a bunch of assets. Some of it is owed to money lenders, and the rest is owned by the owners. Shares of stock represent shares of equity. So if there's 1 million shares of this company, you think of this blue box now as being divided into 1 million little squares. Each one of those little squares gives the owner of that share of stock the right to the 1 millionth share of profits that company management decides to spit out to the shareholders. And these are called dividends. So now you think of the assets of being like a factory. Over, you have a factory that makes, you know, computers or something like that. As it makes the computers, customers are pumping in money to pay for those computers. So the cash is part of these assets. So one thing the management is to elect to plow those assets back into the company to grow it. But another thing that the company could do is, if it doesn't have any smart plans to expand the company, it can spit out that cash back to the owners, which is the form of dividends. All right, so are prices always right? And there are four challenges to that notion from empirical evidence that I'm going to show. The first one is from Robert Shiller, who got the Nobel in 2013 for this work. Basically, what Dr. Shiller showed was, here you're looking at actual stock prices in blue, and in red, you're looking at what the stock price should have been if the stock owner had known what the next 30 years of dividends was going to look like for that stock, right? So if you buy a share of Tesla right now, you don't know if dividends are going to be paid on that stock ever. It could be 10 years from now, it could be 20 years from now, you don't know. But you're buying it partly because you think that Tesla is going to do so well in the future that it's going to have extra cash that it would be able to send to you in the form of dividends. So what this study is saying is that even if you had perfect advanced knowledge of how much dividends would be coming your way as a shareholder, if you had perfect knowledge, you would price the stock like this dotted red line. But what the market actually did was price the stock like this blue line. In other words, there are huge differences between a quote-unquote fair value and what the market determines to be the fair value. And you can see here that these periods of kind of inflation, inflated prices, can last for decades. It's not necessarily the case that, oh, there's a short-term blip in the price. Another example. This is one I was directly involved with, actually. So there was a paper called Liquidity as an Investment Style. And I was a co-author of this with Roger Ibbotson at the School of Management. It did get some play. It won an award for being the paper of the year in the Financial Analyst Journal. That was given by the CFA Institute, which is kind of the credentialing body for investment analysts in the US and actually around the world. That award got picked up by The Economist, which is a UK news magazine. And so here's a chart that I helped to make. And what this is showing is, let's say you take US stocks and you sort them into four bins. The method that you use to determine which bin each stock goes in is you look at the previous year and you ask the question, how much trading volume happened in that stock over the last year? So if it had a lot of trading volume, you'd put it into the fourth, the highest bin of trading volume. Whereas if you have a stock that's basically ignored, nobody cares about it, nobody talks about it, everyone thinks it's not cool to talk about it, that would go in the first bucket here. And what we find is that if you look at the following year's return of that stock, you see this pattern, that the ignored and forgotten stocks are the ones that will outperform in future years, as opposed to the hot stocks that everyone knows and everybody talks about and everybody trades. So that's another very interesting kind of behavioral thing, and it invites kind of a theory of popularity in which you have unpopular things, which everyone has ignored and forgotten about, and as a result, the price goes down because nobody cares about it. Then in the future, some news happens, it becomes hot in the future, and when it becomes hot, when it becomes talked about, then the price goes up. And that is what is explaining these high returns here. And the opposite happens. So if you have some flavor of the day kind of stock that everyone's talking about, those are the ones that you actually want to avoid. You want to have a caution flag on those because those tend to have their day in the sun. You find out about it while it's having its day in the sun. Then its day in the sun is gone. It's 15 minutes or gone. When the interest goes away, then the price goes down too. The dot-com bubble was a time in history when the internet was new. In case there are maybe younger people in the audience who didn't live through the dot-com bubble, it was a very interesting time because if you had any sort of company that had any sort of stupid idea, and you added .com to the end of the company name, people would go crazy for it because it was using this hot new thing called the internet, which was brand spanking new back then. And so there was this company called Pets.com, and its idea was to FedEx 50-pound bags of dog food to people and charge grocery store prices, even though they were, you know, taking a bath on the shipping. But they were using the internet to take their orders. And so this was a hot company. It went through IPO. It actually got investment from Amazon.com, if you can believe that. And it's an example of how a new technology can promote inefficiency in pricing. In other words, when you have a new technology that is not very well understood among a people, that is the time when everyone's going to take their stupid idea, add.com, and advertise it as being the next best thing since sliced bread. And so, of course, very similar thing is happening with blockchain, right? So take any sort of idea you can possibly think of, doesn't matter how stupid it is, and you make it a blockchain thing, you issue an ICO, you know, you might do okay. Finally, are prices always right? Well, if you accept the efficient market hypothesis, then yes, prices are always right. But let's look at just a few years ago. So now we're not talking about the 90s. The internet was new. We're talking just 4 years ago, 3.5 years ago. This is what the market cap list looked like in late October 2017. And you can see number 8 here, there's this thing called BitConnect. And again, if you are new to the crypto space, you should study this. You should study this total scam Ponzi scheme called BitConnect, which managed to become number 8 on the ranking charts as far as cryptocurrency. Part of their official website actually included this pyramid. It would be hard for them to make more obvious that this was a pyramid scheme. And this particular date, October 28, 2017, was the date when this video, which became a sort of classic meme in crypto, came out, in which this gentleman here did very little but scream BitConnect into a microphone, and people thought it was great. So, of course, you had this ironic section of crypto people who kind of laughed at it and thought it was a big joke. But, you know, this is real money. This is like $1.5 billion that people ended up losing to this fraud. Be careful. So is a current high market cap indicative of merit? I'll ask it again. Are prices always right? In 1936, Keynes, the economist, going back to the first slide about Keynes versus Hayek, this is one politically neutral observation that he had. And this was pertaining a newspaper contest that was published in 1936. And so what this contest did was it published 100 photos of attractive people. So 100 photos with 100 names on them. And it said, okay, we're going to do a contest here. And what we want you to do is you pick the 6 prettiest people on this page. You write their names down and you send it into our newspaper. The winner of this contest is going to be whoever it is who chose the most popular pretty photos. So now Keynes's observation was this. What is your best strategy? Is your best strategy to actually pick the 6 photos that you think are the prettiest? That would be maybe your first reaction. But if you think about it a bit more, you might have weird taste, right? You might have taste that is not reflective of everybody else. So the second iteration of your strategy would be, I'm going to pick the 6 people who I think everybody else thinks is pretty. So basically, you imagine what the population thinks they're going to like, and you're going to guess that. You can even take that a step further. You can say, okay, well, that's okay, but other guys are going to do that too. So what I need to do is I need to think about the people who are thinking about everybody else and selecting what they think the 6 prettiest, right? So it gets very circular, gets very complicated. Keynes's observation was that this is really what the stock market is like. It's not direct merit that price is capturing. It's the derivative of it. And it has an estimation of what you think everyone else is thinking in it. So that leads to this quote here. In the short run, the market is a voting machine, but in the long run, it is a weighing machine. In the short run, it's a popularity contest, and popularity contests can have winners that are not necessarily the most meritorious. But in the long run, those kind of popularity fads are going to come and go, and what you're left with is merit in the long term. All right, so behavioral economics, there was one particularly important Nobel Prize that pinpointed two very specific things that people do that are not rational. If you don't know these, this is, I would say, among the most important discoveries, I'd say, of the 20th century. I mean, this is important to know, and not everyone knows it. So if you know it and other people don't, you're going to have a bit of an edge on them. This is called prospect theory, and the reason it's called prospect theory is that it talks about how people make decisions about their future prospects. They have two main observations. Number one, people perceive the pain of loss more intensely than equally sized gains. So going back to the econ, this, you know, Dr. Spock character who the classical economics is based on, this classic character, like basically a robot, if you go up to a robot and say, we're going to flip a coin, if it comes up heads, I'm going to give you a dollar, if it comes up tails, I'm going to take a dollar from you, then the robot should think that's a neutral game. They should not really have an opinion on it. But if you go to a human and do that, if I were to come up to you and say, we're going to flip a coin, if it's heads, I'm giving you a dollar, if it's tails, I'm taking a dollar from you. Now think of what's going to happen when we do that game, and it comes up heads, I give you a dollar, and you say, oh, okay, great, thanks, won a dollar. Let's say it comes out the opposite, I take a dollar from you. Well, you know, our friendship might be over, basically, like, you know, you might not invite me to lunch next time. Things like that are processed by a different part of the brain than the part of the brain that processes reward. It's basically a more primal part of the brain that is processing negative consequences. And there could be evolutionary basis for this. So imagine caveman one walks by a tiger cave and says, oh, there's only a 1% chance that the tiger's in there and it's going to eat me. So, you know, I'm going to go because it's, you know, it's just a 1% chance, and then they get eaten. Caveman B walks by the same cave and says, oh, there's a tiger in there. There's no way I'm getting anywhere near that. I don't care what the probability is. So basically, it could be that the people who overemphasized threats were the ones who survived evolutionarily. So neoclassical person, here I'm showing a utility curve. On the horizontal axis, we're looking at something like wealth. So this is how much wealth you have. And on the vertical axis, we're talking about how happy you are with your wealth. And what you see for neoclassical person is law of diminishing returns, which you might be familiar with from economics, that says, if you have sat through a long day of 9 talks at a crypto conference, then the additional value to you of the 10th talk, which happens to be my talk today, number 10, is not going to be that much better, right? So like, you don't get that much additional happiness out of that talk number 10. That is why this curve flattens out. It never starts going down. It's never the case that more wealth makes you less happy. It's like the rate of happiness increase slows down as you get richer. All right, so this is neoclassical robot person. How do actual people behave? The behavioral function looks like this, in which it matters where your current level is. If your current level is here on wealth, then you will act rationally about that one additional dollar. But if you think about the prospect of $1 being taken from you, now that's a different situation. You become much less happy. And in fact, it turns out to be about twice as unhappy. So basically, a $1 loss makes you approximately the same emotional reaction as a $2 gain. So this is a key insight, and it's something to know that you might be doing when you are thinking about potential losses. They will be magnified in your brain. Prospect theory, the second part, is that people crudely approximate probabilities into 3 categories. So here I'm plotting. On the horizontal axis is an actual probability of something happening. And on the vertical axis, this is the perceived probability. This is what a human being thinks the probability is in their brain when they're deciding what to do. So neoclassical robot person here has no bias. Whatever the actual probability is, that's going to be the exact perception of the probability, and they will act rationally. How do actual people behave? Actual people tend to categorize probabilities into three crude buckets. Those buckets are never going to happen, maybe, so basically a 50-50 coin flip, and for sure, right? So if something has a 1% chance of happening, people often will simply simplify that and say, never going to happen. Or you could have people who round up and say that 1% chance is going to happen like 50-50. So it turns out that people are pretty bad at assessing probabilities. And it turns out that what you would think of as standard measures of intelligence, they will not exempt a genius from being susceptible to this bias. It happens to them too. All right, so let's apply that. Okay, I'm the insurance company, and I'm going to offer you, because planes are scary and dangerous, and they could fall out of the sky. You know, it's been known to happen. So we're going to offer you this $100,000 insurance policy, and we will pay that if your plane crashes. What is the actual probability of that happening? Well, of course, you know it's going to be very, very small. It's about 1 in 10 million. Let's say you charge 1 penny for that insurance policy as the insurance company. That means 10 million times people are going to pay a penny. One of those times out of the 10 million, somebody's going to crash, and you as the insurance company are going to have to pay out the $100,000. The 10 million pennies that you collected, that is the same as $100,000. In other words, the $100,000 you collected as premiums is the same as the $100,000 you paid out as a payment. So the fair price for an insurance policy like this is 1 penny. Why do they sell this? They sell this because they know that there's a subset of people who are going to take that 1 in a million probability, and in their minds, instead of rounding it down to the never bucket, because it's a fear, they're going to round that probability up to the maybe bucket. This is an exaggerated perception of loss. So that's the first part of prospect theory, remember? So if you're thinking about a loss versus a gain, your brain is going to magnify the badness of that bad thing. It's like little kids being scared of a monster under the covers. Your imagination is going to come up with something crazy, and because the bad thing, you're going to magnify the importance of that or the likelihood of that. So in this case, the person that they're targeting, the customer type that an insurance company like this is trying to make a buck off of, is the type of person who has an exaggerated perception of loss. And so their perceived probability of a crash gets rounded up to the maybe bucket instead of the never going to happen bucket. So let's say this person now thinks that they have a 1 in 1,000 chance of being in a plane crash. Every 1,000 flights, they're going to die once. And so if they think that, then it's going to be worth $100 to them to have a policy that pays $100,000 upon death. And so, of course, this company is going to price their thing at like $50. You know, it's grossly overpriced for the insurance that they're offering. But they're going to be enough suckers to make it a profitable thing. This is an example of a predatory use of the natural human tendency to have these biases. But my purpose in this talk is to try to get you to think about ways you could be aware of this. So as you continue on in your education in the crypto space, you're aware of these biases, both in yourself and in other people that you talk with. All right, so I was saying that these biases happen to quote-unquote smart people as well as not-so-smart people. So here's the example of long-term capital management. This was a hedge fund in Connecticut, also in the mid-90s. And if you wanted blue ribbon panel of smart people on your hedge fund, this one had it. This one had Scholes. You might have heard of Black-Scholes. That is a famous formula that was derived by Scholes to determine a fair price for options. And that was also a Nobel Prize winning innovation. And so these gentlemen were both on the board of directors. And as you can see in the blue line, the performance of this hedge fund was fantastic for a while, and then it crashed. And one of the things that they lost on was the Russian default on Russian bonds that happened in mid-1998. Long-term capital management had the logic of the following. The Russians owe money on these bonds that they paid, but these bonds were not denominated in dollars or something, or euros or whatever. These bonds were denominated in Russian rubles, and the Russians had the printing presses to their own rubles. So what's the probability that the Russians are going to default on those bonds? It's got to be zero, because they own the printing presses to the thing that they have to pay back, right? It's kind of as if you had a mortgage on your house, and to pay back the mortgage, you were allowed to pay it back with monopoly money that you printed out on your inkjet printer. It's the same situation. So of course, why would they default? And it turns out they defaulted. So this was a case of oversimplifying a probability. They thought of the probability of default as being so small, it was negligible, and they rounded it down to zero when they shouldn't have. So this happens to everybody, but not you, because you're watching this talk. How can you apply this in crypto? So in crypto, there's a lot of FUD, F-U-D, and that stands for fear, uncertainty, and doubt. And so this is basically slander that often comes out against one crypto project or another. And part of your job as you navigate cryptocurrency is to make sense of this. What are you going to do with it? Like, you can't just ignore it. You have to evaluate it somehow. But oftentimes these are things that are difficult to prove. And so what are you going to do? What you want to do is be aware that you're going to have an innate tendency to say, eh, won't happen. Or, oh yeah, it's going to happen. Or, eh, it's a coin flip, it might happen. That's going to be your tendency. You need to be aware of that, because if you give into that, that can be an expensive decision, because the actual probabilities matter. The fair value of any asset is the sum of the probability of every possible future outcome times that future value. Know that you're going to tend to oversimplify the probability and resist that impulse. And you should also know that because it's fear, uncertainty, and doubt, they're designed to trigger that loss impulse in your mind. So it's going to get magnified in your brain. So I would say to try to think about it clinically, think about it objectively, think of it like some sort of math problem, that your challenge is to estimate the probability of some event happening. As an example for this, I would like to talk about this, and I saw this in the chat earlier. What's the probability that the whole world bans Monero? Now, so we saw an interesting talk from Justin earlier that had kind of a takeaway message that it's not obvious that a given country, for example, the United States, will want to ban Monero from centralized exchanges, because then it's going to lose a bunch of information that it would have otherwise been able to access by being able to regulate that exchange. If it bans it, then all the trading is going to go to forums that it has no information in. So it actually might be in the best interest of a given government to allow it. So now I want to take that one further. I want to look at the entire world, right? So effective worldwide ban would need to be coordinated globally. It wouldn't really work for one country to say, okay, we're going to ban Monero, and everyone else is like, oh, yeah, whatever. It's still cool here. Not much of a ban. You have to have everyone like on board, right? You got to coordinate this, and then on some day, you got to be like, okay, we world governments have all come to the conclusion that we're doing this ban, right? All the important countries would need to participate. So certainly you'd think of the big ones, the US, the Eurozone, China, and Russia. So immediately, here are four countries that don't have consistent record in all getting along and singing kumbaya on anything. But beyond that, each of these countries has to choose ban or no ban. Each country is, as a sovereign unit, they get to choose, do we cooperate in this worldwide ban or do we not cooperate? So the cooperating option I'm putting in green and the non-cooperative option I'm putting in red. So if everyone in the world bans it, all the world governments, okay, they say, hooray, no more Monero. However, let's say one or more countries do not go along with this scheme and they elect to not ban. So they say no ban. What's going to happen? Then the countries that did a no ban, they're going to get an incoming influx of brain power working on this form of fungible, decentralized digital value. Now, all of a sudden, maybe this is not what the ban people were thinking. They were not intending for a reward in global innovation to go to the countries that were not cooperating. And yet, this is a classic problem in game theory. It's called the prisoner's dilemma problem. The prisoner's dilemma problem goes like this. You have two suspects, and they've been captured by the police, and they've been detained, and now they're being interrogated in separate rooms, so they can't talk to each other. So you have perp one and perp two. Each of these detained people can decide, am I going to rat on the other guy? Am I going to tell the police that the other guy did it? Or am I going to keep my mouth shut and not betray my, you know, partner in crime here? That's the decision that each of these people have. What is the outcome based on what they do? So if neither of the suspects rat, then they both go free because the police didn't get any confessions out of any of them. If they both rat on each other, they both stay in jail. The interesting situation happens if one of the guys decides to betray his chum, but the other guy does not choose to betray. That is rat and no rat. What happens then? Then the dishonorable person, the rat, gets to go free because his buddy didn't blame him. He gets to go free. The guy who was actually doing the quote-unquote honorable thing by sticking with his teammate, he's going to stay in jail. This is called a prisoner's dilemma. Okay, so I'm pointing out that a global ban on Monero is kind of like the prisoner's dilemma, but is there any more real-world data that we can use to put a little more light on this question? And the answer is yes. It turns out that in the 90s, there was a game show called Golden Balls. You can go on YouTube and watch some episodes of this, but basically the end of every episode of Golden Balls was a prisoner's dilemma. You have two finalists, and each one can choose, do I steal the jackpot or do I split the jackpot? And the jackpots vary. It was usually 1,000 to 100,000 British pounds. So that'd be like 2,000 to 200,000 US dollars. Although towards the end of that period, it would have been 1,500 to 150,000 US dollars. So basically, if the two contestants agree to be nice to each other, if they go split, then each contestant wins half the money. If one person is dishonorable and chooses to steal, but the other person is nice, then the stealer wins all the money. The nice person gets nothing. And if they both choose to steal, the TV show keeps the entire jackpot. And so a picture being worth 1,000 words, these are very entertaining. Here are two ladies, and they both said they were going to split, and so they both go home winners. It's like the daughter and mother finding the daughter and the mother that they never had all of a sudden. Very heartwarming moment. Here's one where the woman on the left has chosen to steal the entire jackpot from the shell-shocked man on the right, who is revealing that his decision was split. They have these golden balls. One has the word steal and one has the word split in it. So that's one source of the name Golden Balls. So in the look of betrayal and shock on the guy who is nice, but now he's going to go home with nothing, contrast with the, well, of course, she's jumping up and down inside because she stole the entire jackpot. But on the downside, she's being exposed on national TV as being somewhat of a twit and is finding it difficult to look this guy in the eye. And then here we have a case of two stealers. Here you can see that they were both revealing that they were planning to stab each other in the back, and the faces kind of say a lot. So that's all very entertaining. But what's really fascinating was that there was an academic paper that studied all of the 150 final rounds of Golden Balls, and they did an analysis. What makes the contestants more likely to cooperate versus not cooperate? And so the key result from this paper I'm showing here is this, that as the jackpot went up, so that's the horizontal axis on this plot. So as you go from 100 pounds to 1,000 pounds to 100,000 pounds, you're going to the right. And then on the vertical axis, this is the probability that the two contestants were nice to each other and did a chop-chop, a split-split of the pot, and both went home happy. You can see when the pot was like 10 pounds, they're like, ah, yeah, okay, we'll just split it, right? I mean, it's not worth looking like a jerk on national TV. But once you get into the quote-unquote life-changing amounts of 100,000 pounds, now the probability that each one is going to go home with half of it goes down because they observe that if they're greedy, they could go home with even more. What does this inform us with the prisoner's dilemma problem as applied to a global ban on cryptocurrency? It is that as the perceived value of cryptocurrency increases, a global ban is going to become less likely because any country that doesn't cooperate with the ban is going to capture more of the economic value that comes with being a beacon of freedom that would allow basically smart geeks to come settle in and help build this new economy with this efficient new form of money. So basically, since the price of crypto keeps getting more valuable, this is saying that game theoretically, a global ban becomes less likely as time goes on. All right, so there are a lot more examples of things like this, but I'll stop here. Here's my summary of behavioral crypto. Market prices are not always correct. You should keep that in mind. Market prices are not always correct, especially for any widely misunderstood new technology. In 1993, that was the internet. It's happening again now. One question that is unresolved that happened in the dot-com era. In the dot-com era, there was kind of a battle that was forming between two visions of what the internet would be. One was a wild west of the open internet, in which you could just get on with a browser and type whatever you wanted in the address bar, and it would take you there. That was just like wild west, because anyone could put up a website, anyone could do whatever they want, and anyone was free to go everywhere they want. That's like this crazy world that was envisioned. That was kind of one direction that the internet could have gone. The other was exemplified by a company called America Online, AOL, and what they offered was a walled garden sort of experience. So basically, you would not be on the internet if you were an AOL customer. You would be on AOL's curated version of the internet. So it's like, okay, I'm going to take away your Mozilla web browser, and I'm just going to give you this other app, and you'll be able to choose like websites that we approved for you. You know, you'll be happy with it. You'll like it. People didn't want it. People wanted the wide open Wild West. But we're in a point in crypto that is very like that crossroads that was in the internet in the mid-90s. That is, do we want an open blockchain? You have a Wild West of different projects out there with different ethos. Or do you have AOL? So you would go to a custodian, and the custodian would take care of all these crypto choices for you, and they'd serve it up to you on a sanitized little platter that you could then click and choose from. So we're in a similar situation now. It's not really clear what's going to win. All right, so part of behavioral economics is the observation that people tend to overemphasize losses compared to gains. They also tend to oversimplify probabilities into three buckets: yes, no, and maybe. Smart people have these biases too. It's funny. It's like if you kind of look at the general tenor of people's tweets or, you know, whatever, they tend to get more and more confident and then more and more arrogant as the price goes up. So currently the price of Bitcoin's been up. Over time, these mispricing biases tend to resolve. That is, even though there can be temporary dispositions in the true price versus a market price, these tend to go away over time. That is, if you know that other people are biased and they're making estimates of valuation based on biased estimators, you know that they're biased and you think you have a better version of it. If you're right, that's an investing strategy. In fact, we call this value investing. This is exemplified by Benjamin Graham, whose quote I read earlier, but of course the most famous proponent of this style investing is Warren Buffett. Basically, what Warren Buffett does is he looks for companies that nobody cares about. They've been forgotten. They're doing something that's not sexy. They're doing something that's all fuddy-duddy, not very exciting. And he sees that their prices are low. And he loads up on them, and he waits. All right, so that's all I have. Put the earphones back in. If you'd like to get in touch with me, if you're looking for maybe a Sherpa who can help you kind of align your strategy with principles based on academic finance, but also based on real-world experience, also a solid connection, like I mentioned before, between the worlds of open source, cypherpunk, cryptocurrencies, and the more traditional aspects of wealth management, estate planning, trusts. So trusts are a potential way that you can change the jurisdiction of your assets in a 100% legal and upfront way. Things like this are what I can help my clients with. So that's it. Thanks.